I'm sorry everyone, I have no idea what is wrong today, though I have refreshed and I've rebooted my phone. Something is wrong with our internet today. I'm not sure what is wrong with my internet. Everything is right. Something is wrong with internet or Instagram Live is just a sucky place to begin with. I connected this time, otherwise I'm not doing this session today.
it could be an issue because of, like, I mean there are still issues here all over the place. You never not, really know.
No, it does not happen like this. And I mean, I switched from Wi-Fi to my mobile data, and I don't
right.
think. Yeah, I'm not sure what is wrong right now. I mean, I just hope it does not happen again.
It could be an issue with the Wi-Fi, so maybe, like, let's hope that mobile data works. Yeah.
And I also rebooted my phone just in case agar koi issue ho raha ho to, which is
definitely yeah. Arrest nahi lena chahiye.
Yeah, everybody's yeah. laughing right now because they're also. I'm glad that they're just laughing. Hi, Radhika.
So it happens to everyone. It happens to the best of us.
Yeah. So I think we would have to start, you know.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Maybe the data provider is a chosen one. He doesn't really want. I think it's yeah. We're back on. Yeah.
Thank God. Yeah.
Yeah, I was scared. I got scared when the white circle appeared on your face again, and I was like, "Are you?"
Okay, so for me, it appears on your face. My face, I mean, my video still works. Okay, so it's very difficult to understand what is the problem. I think it's in Instagram. It is the chosen one, as Ankita said. Anyway, let's try and wrap this up as quickly as we can and shorten our discussion a little bit. So, Sanjay Shukla is the chosen one. And I'm sorry to keep going back to the same question again. But could you, you know, quickly point out the difference, if there is any, between a hero and a protagonist?
Well, so essentially, as we've spoken about it, the difference, not every hero is a protagonist. And if you think about it, someone like, I'm trying to think of a different example for this type, but someone like Neville Longbottom, at the end of the day. is not the protagonist of Harry Potter, but he is still the hero. He does a lot of selfless things. He has his moments. He's not there in the constant limelight, but at the end of the day, he's a part, and he does things which are important. Does making him a hero, and not every protagonist is at the end of the day a hero. So there's a different perspective to it altogether. Like someone like Sansa Stark. She is not the hero of Game of Thrones. Game of Thrones doesn't have one hero. Mm-hmm. They have a multitude of heroes. But at the end of the day, if you think about it, Sansa didn't do as much herself when compared to someone like Arya or Bran or Jon. So,
Bran did nothing. Like Bran is not a protagonist for me.
Bran is not a protagonist per se, but at the same time, he is... still a substantial character.
He
He has an impact on the series towards the end of it, really in the start, and there's a lot of confusion for most of the part of Game of Thrones. But then at the end of the day, he is someone severe and major, and someone who impacts the story by quite a bit. Right there, if you think about it, Sansa is not really the hero, but she's still the protagonist of the show.
Sorry. So I think to borrow from the idea that you have spoken about, Sarvesh, we can, you know, probably come to a conclusion that not all heroes, as you said, you know, like all heroes are protagonists, but not all protagonists are heroes, right?
Yeah.
So long as somebody out there in the world wants to do good for the world and not just for himself, we can consider that person is a hero. And at the same time, there are also examples when there have been characters who are not exactly protagonists, but they still have gone to do heroic things, which people then remember as an unsung hero, which is why the whole concept came up, which we will speak towards the end. So right now we are going to, you know, talk about something which is also there in our title, which says the chosen one. And as I was speaking in the last session that got disconnected, so the chosen one is a concept that these creators and authors have borrowed from religious texts than mythological books, because Bhagavad Gita, Quran, Bible, all of these have mentioned time and again about the Messiah, the Savior, the Protector, you know. So these are, in a way, if you talk in a very literal sense, these are the chosen ones, the heroes, which were promised to the world. So that these people would come and they would, you know, help us with everything that is wrong in the world, and they would put it in place. So in that sense, Sarvesh, I ask you, like, so does that mean that being a hero has got nothing to do with your own self? Is it all destiny? Is it all, you know, the choice of God, the choice of something superior? Or, you know, like, where does this whole concept of the chosen one, you know, stands for you? Like, as a person who enjoys popular pop culture as well as films and movies and books.
So, if you think about it, the entire concept of a chosen one, or the entire concept of one person being the protagonist and the hero at the same time, the choice has a multitude of consequence of some higher power in certain ways, or some consequence which is created by one individual person who could be either the villain or God, and at the same time, quite a bit about the person's values or the person's their own self-conscious choice at the end of the day. So in popular fan fictions and in popular fictions altogether, if you look at them, you'll see that at the end of the day, a lot of people ultimately didn't want to be the hero in the start. Their perspective was, why me? Why do I have to go through all of the suffering at the end of the day? But they end up being the hero. They end up being someone.
I mean, I can think of so many examples because we're taking a pop culture as a reference. So even in Harry, as you said, like, you know, Neville and Harry were both born on the same day, and the prophecy which prophesized about Harry Potter coming into the world and killing the Dark Lord, which Sybil Trelawney refers to, and which is such a central part of the story. So that could easily win for Neville as well, but it ends up only with Harry. So, you know, so who decided that it's Harry and it's not Neville? That is like the question.
Yeah, and ultimately we do see that it's Voldemort. At the end of the day, it is Voldemort who gets to decide. Trelawney did the prophecy. I am not sure about the pronunciation there. And then Snape overheard it, took it to Voldemort, and Voldemort was the one that, you know, Bellatrix, you go to Longbottom's house, and I'll go to the Potter's house. And he is the one who marked him. And that's what the prophecy said. In Harry Potter, if you remember it, the Dark Lord will mark him as his own. Like, as his own enemy. And that's what he did.
Because they share the same wand. I mean, the core of the same wand, right?
The core of the same wand. The fact that he was a Horcrux. So essentially, Voldemort, in a way, created his own devil.
Yeah.
If you think about it, another one of the heroes and protagonists who's known for creating his own devils, but he's in a completely different light when compared to Voldemort. He's actually the hero. Is someone like Iron Man. And the entire concept of Iron Man 3 is dealing with his past created devils. The entire concept of that is dealing with his past created devils. Iron Man is a man of consequence, ultimately. He created his weapons and he got kidnapped for them. Because of his own technology. And that resulted in him being kidnapped, and that resulted in him becoming Iron Man. Tony Stark becoming Iron Man. That change that we see. The hero in the making.
And the hero.
So that entire concept, if you think about it, is vast. It's huge. And there are a lot of fiction stories and some real life stories as well, which borrow from it, which go on the same ground rules. It's pretty vast in that way.
I think we can rightly say that when we talk about the chosen one, so a part of it has to do with the prophecies and the higher self and the universe and all of those things which are unknown, right? So it's destiny. And then it also is, at the end of the day, the person who has been prophesized, the person who is, you know, who has the weight of carrying that thing for the rest of his life. So there, you know, a very interesting you know, manifestation comes out, that so many times we have seen that the people who are the chosen one, they do not really want to be heroes in real life. They just want to live a normal life. And then there are characters who want to get recognition, you know, who see that by becoming or doing something good, they can probably, you know, come to a level where people will start noticing and acknowledging them. Not as to speak that they want to become heroes, but in some cases they want that appreciation, or they want that sort of a status that allows them, you know, to see, to probably, you know, for other people to see them. So to quote some examples, like let's take up Harry Potter and Neville Longbottom in Harry Potter series by J.K. Rowling. And we can take up Robb Stark and Jon Snow from A Song of Ice and Fire by George R.R. Martin. So, yeah. Which one would you like to speak on about first?
Well, I feel that Robb's character relates far more to the want of a hero than compared to Neville. So, I guess let's go with Robb. Plus, I'm wearing a Game of Thrones t-shirt.
Yeah, let's go with Robb. Yeah, because we've discussed Harry right now. So
Yeah.
And also because you're wearing Stark t-shirt, so
I'm wearing a Stark t-shirt. I mean, this t-shirt has like three correlations. So one, it has a Lannister colors because I love House Lannister.
Yeah.
It has the Stark logo.
Yeah.
And it has the Gryffindor colors. Because I'm a Gryffindor at the end of the day.
Yeah.
So if you think about the example of Robb, after his father's death, the hanging, and them declaring war, Robb is trying to do something good. He's trying to be the guy who avenges his dad, who is the hero here, because he's the person ultimately who is doing the right, because Ned Stark was unrightfully killed, essentially.
Also that, you know, he's uniting the entire North to go and and, you know, rebel against the crown itself. Because as you remember back then, the North was a part of the Seven Kingdoms.
Seven Kingdoms.
The Robert Baratheons. Even though his death technically fell under Joffrey.
Exactly. So the entire concept of Robb Stark was meant to be the fact that he could be the guy who could save it all. Who could essentially overthrow the Lannisters. Who could bring a big change in the entire story.
He was a fighter, if you remember, Sarvesh.
He was a pure, proper fighter. Yeah.
He was quite a fighter, and he had quite determination, and he had a strategic way of planning things. And because, you know, the Lannister army was a huge army, because you know they were paid in gold, versus the Northerners who were collectively coming together for a common cause, and it was completely based on self-interest and, you know, the motivation to do good in the world. So that way, Robb Stark was a hero for a lot of us, you know, from the starting. But what happened to Robb Stark? We were snatched away. And another character who I have never liked in my life, Jon Snow. And he's such a problematic character. Sometimes I just wanted to get inside the screen and slap him right across his face and tell him, what are you doing?
Right? But isn't that true for a lot of heroes that we know? Sometimes I felt like doing that for Harry Potter as well.
Yeah, in the initial few books.
Just in the initial few books. Even in something like Order of the Phoenix.
Yeah.
In the fifth book, I was like, why? You know he's messing with your head. You know that Sirius is not there. I mean, it's impossible that a wanted criminal is there in the Ministry of Magic. Why would you go there? It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah. So in that sense, you know, like, could you speak a little about why... these heroes who we want to be heroes, they end up dying, and why do these characters who do not want to be heroes, they end up being the hero? And let's pick up Jon Snow right now, because, you know, you spoke about Robb Stark.
So essentially, if you think about like Jon Snow's character, he's a character that we're supposed to, in a way, I believe, empathize with. You can see the pain, you can see, you know, the discontent that Jon Snow goes through. He's not accepted by the Stark family completely.
Yeah. I mean, I'll just cut you here. I remembered something which is very interesting. On Facebook, I had once ranted about Jon Snow. It was, I think, the sixth or the seventh season. And it was a ranting post. And somebody had commented that Jon Snow is the Karna from Mahabharata in Game of Thrones. only that he ends up being on the right side, because Karna's character has gone through so much of wrong thing. He has all, like, you know, Karna's whole character is a tragedy in itself. The very fact he was, he supported Duryodhana, despite the fact knowing that Duryodhana is wrong, right? And the Kauravas will anyway lose the battle, and yet he stayed with. Okay. But same with Jon Snow. But the person who said this said that the Jon Snow is Karna from in Game of Thrones, but he's the Karna who chose to switch the side and, you know, come as a hero, because Karna was a tragic hero, right? We don't really remember Karna in a good light. So
we don't. That's true.
So, you know, so now you can continue.
Yeah, I think that fits in a lot of senses, considering the fact that Karan was essentially even the eldest brother of the Pandavas. Like, Jon Snow is the eldest brother for the Starks. Yeah. So in a lot of ways it fits, but I mean, it's not 100% parallel. Like, exactly. it's not exact.
Exactly.
So,
you don't even expect George R. R. Martin to read Bhagavad Gita before writing.
Exactly. I mean, for someone who's written that much, he wouldn't really have time to read the Bhagavad Gita, I believe.
Yeah.
And we would want him to devote all his time to writing. So right, that we can get the books, all of them at least.
Yeah. So yeah, coming back to the topic, yeah.
Yeah, so if you think about Jon Snow at the end of the day, he is that empathetic, he's a tragedy-oriented character who perhaps, you know, everyone falls in love with because of the fact that we want right to happen for him. The way he, like, in the first season itself, he goes to the Night's Watch. In the first season itself, he's cut out, essentially. So, and from that point, from him being to the Night's Watch, from him going out to north of the wall, till him coming down so far south that he takes down the Lannisters. That entire journey is essentially what you would call a hero in the making. Yeah. Even though we don't see him as the chosen one in the start, it seems like Daenerys is the chosen one in the start. That twist that Game of Thrones is known for, essentially. The fact that they randomly kill off characters, the fact that they randomly bring in new characters, the fact that someone like Tyrion can go from being a self-absorbed, drinking peace person to marrying Sansa to ultimately being with Daenerys Targaryen and conquering the world in a way.
Yeah,
so from that conversion of a character, that's what Game of Thrones is essentially about. And in that very sense, Jon Snow is quite aptly the hero of Game of Thrones in some senses or the other. From his sacrifice in the end with Daenerys to his entire path to being a hero, to him having perhaps a tragic start, he's a cliched hero of Game of Thrones at the end of the day.
No, also, you know, I mean, it is very important to acknowledge the fact over here that, you know, all those people who have come up and, you know, told me that Jon Snow, you know, does not really deserve to be a hero and everything. I think somewhere I knew it from the very start, after the moment, you know, because until his reveal, like, he is actually Aegon Targaryen. So until then, we used to think that he is a Targaryen, right? Once he was revealed, he is a Targaryen indeed. That is when the entire series, as the title says, A Song of Ice and Fire.
Ice and Fire, yeah.
It comes into your head because it was Jon Snow who brings the Targaryens and the Starks together. Because Targaryen is fire and Starks are snow or winter or whatever you want to call it, ice. So, you know, bringing two polar opposites together. So, in a way, he is, you know, half, because he's the son of Lyanna Stark as well as Rhaegar Targaryen. So, he has 50% of ice as well as 50% of snow in him. So, fire in him.
Yeah.
You know, so that whole thing, you know, the whole prophecy there fits. Because a lot of times I've seen, you know, people commenting that what was the entire point of revealing or making Jon a Targaryen, because it absolutely does not conclude in anything, right?
Yeah.
It doesn't work anyway. It's just a revelation. And when it happened, all of the GOT fans were so happy about it. But nothing goes beyond that. So I think it is not to do with a consequence, but it is to do with the fact that he was the chosen one in that sense. because it was only him who could have brought this fire and the snow together, because he had both of them inside of him, right?
Yeah, essentially. And then again, being a Targaryen comes with its perks, like, you know, the fact that you're in a way unburnt, the fact that you have a far better communication skill with dragons, which were essentially a major part of the show. And then, and being a Stark, or having ice in your blood, essentially comes with its own perks. That the fact that you're truly from North, the fact that you were born and brought up there, and the fact that you have their support, which is essentially loyalty, pure loyalty. That's what the North was all about.
But as North in Game of Thrones is always, you know, stood for loyalty and for, you know, like the right kind of picture that, you know, forms in our mind.
Essentially. The stability. They were the ones that essentially were the spine, or, you know, they were together at all points of time. Mm-hmm. If you can think about it, if you go that far back.
So I think, Sarvesh, you know, that sort of brings us to a very important thing. That is, even though that Jon Snow, in some ways, he was, as we discussed, he was the ice and he was the fire, because, you know, he's the child of Rhaegar Targaryen and Lyanna Stark. But it also has to do a lot about who Jon Snow is and what qualities he has. Okay. So even though he's a little dumb, in my opinion, but he's extremely courageous and he's extremely bold. Because going north of the wall, not once, but thrice, and coming back alive, fighting the Night King, the White Walkers and all the whites, is a sheer sense of bravery. So that...
Yeah, essentially.
So that sort of, you know, puts us in a position where we have to, you know, point out that what happens about the thing, about the fact that, you know, these people, or the people who come out as heroes, they have something within themselves, right? So would you say that the spirit or the insider qualities of a human are also important contributing factor in being a hero, other than the fact that they're also prophesized? And maybe you can take up Tony Stark as an example, because he is a self-made hero, as you mentioned in the beginning.
You know, talking first about Jon Stark's most heroic moments. If you think about it, I feel that the most iconic moment that Jon Stark had was in the battle against Ramsay Bolton for the control of... Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because I'm the one who refuses to read the books till all of them come out, because I don't want the disappointment in my life that I'm not able to read all those books. So I'm speaking from the series' perspective. And if you think about it from the series' perspective, that one look of a man with a sword standing in front of an entire army ready to battle, regardless of what happens. That one scene is what portrays him as the hero the most. Yeah. And if you think about the values side of it, Jon Snow had them. Tony Stark had them. And Tony Stark's entire perspective of life, of the world, or how it drastically changed from him being self-absorbed to him becoming the biggest philanthropist that you could ever think about. To him giving up his life to save everyone else. He's a character that goes through several waves in his life. He's the guy who loses his family. He's the guy who finds out that his best friend betrayed him. He's the guy who separates himself from everyone. He's the guy who ends up becoming the first member of the Avengers who got a family as the series progressed. Because the only person who already had a family was Hawkeye. And the only person who got a family at the end of the series was Tony. Who got a family as the series progressed.
Because for the rest of them, I think the entire concept of Avengers is based on the fact that Avengers themselves became a family. So, Natasha Romanoff, when she, you know, performs the final act of sacrificing herself, so she does it because she knows that she does not have a family of her own. And this is the only bunch of people in the world who are as close as a family to her. So, in that
I guess we should hold that thought, because there's a movie coming.
Yeah.
Black Widow, which is all about her family. I think we should hold that thought, because we'll get to know a lot about Agent Romanoff in that movie, so.
In that movie, yeah. So I think, Sarvesh, you spoke a lot about how Tony Stark, who was a philanthropist, playboy, billionaire, his so-called cliche line, he went on to becoming a self-made man who started, you know, choosing to put his actions in a way that helped make the world a better and a greater place. So that is a very interesting aspect, because if you look at it, Harry Potter or Tony Stark or Jon Snow or all of these people, they have a very similar plot, okay? In so as to speak that all of these heroes follow a similar set of structure or a similar path where they come across similar challenges and they overcome it, right? And this is what is known as a monomyth structure, which we will discuss right now. And for those who do not know, monomyth structure was a structure that was given by Joseph Campbell, who was a political writer. And he sort of, you know, studied ancient texts and mythological stories and fables. And he discovered that every single story in this world is the same. They follow the same pattern. It's just that you have different characters and you have different motivations, but in the end, it's all same. As Itisha D pointed out rightly, Carl Jung's theory. So yes, he also borrowed a lot from Carl Jung. Thank you for pointing that out. Itisha D is an assistant professor at Delhi University, and she's great. She also has a session. So guys, stay tuned for that as well.
Anyway, wait, just 1 second. 1 second. I believe Shruti just joined us and she said that she just woke up and she's filled with regret. To that, yeah. I say, Shruti, have some chai.
Yeah, Shruti, have some chai.
Have some chai.
They're right now here. Yeah, Shruti, so I will never see this day in my life again when I'm teaching Shruti something, because it's always the other way. So, yeah, Shruti, so we were talking about monomyth structure by Joseph Campbell. And as Itisha Di pointed out, Joseph Campbell, took it from Carl Jung's theory. And it's said that all stories at the end of the day are the same, right? So if you look at each of these journeys of these characters, they are called the hero's journey, right? And this hero's journey progresses in a certain way. So it has around 12 stages, which can be divided into three acts. And these three acts are usually what is used in a book or in a movie. And it's a structural plot as to how the movies or the books are written. So I'm going to talk a little about what is the monomyth structure in brief. And Sarvesh, probably if you can take up example for each stage so that, you know, our audience can learn what monomyth is. So the first is usually the first act of a film or a book or any story is known as the usual world. And the first stage of that, inside that umbrella of the usual world, is the ordinary world. In this, you have the setting where, you know, the book opens, the movie starts, you meet your character, you meet the protagonist, you get to know the world, you see who is who, you see the kind of lifestyle that these people live. You know, it can be the protagonist, it can be the antagonist, anyone, right?
Yeah.
And for example, if you start with Iron Man, or if you start with Harry Potter, if you start with even with Game of Thrones, you're instantly introduced to the kind of lifestyle, the mood, the setting of these people. So that sort of, forms the usual ordinary world. Here, the character or the protagonist or the hero is at peace. He is safely in his world. So over to you, an example.
Yeah. Adi, just 1 second, Chaitanya. Adi, I will take you up on that offer, although I won't be joining you for it. But we need to meet. It's been a long time. So, yes. So, if you think about it, the entire concept, as you said, is very much similar in a lot of novels and a lot of stories. And at the end of the day, yes. If you think about Tony Stark, him being in his world, when you start off, when first Iron Man came out, he was in his own world. He was doing his deals. He was selling his weapons. He was making money out of it. He was chilling. Yeah. Essentially, he was chilling. Even in Avengers, even the first movie of Avengers itself, you see that Avengers, when he lands, when the Stark Tower lights up, and the arc reactor lights up and the entire building is up. You know, Tony Stark comes and his armor gets off and he's told that Agent Coulson's on the line. He doesn't really want to be in that fight. He never agrees to, you know, himself go for the Tesseract. It's just that he being a hero, he comes out of his entire, you know, cave in a way and wants to go for that fight.
Similarly
with Harry. When Hagrid finds Harry Potter in that lighthouse in an island out of nowhere.
I will stop you here because I think you're moving on to the next stage, which is the call to adventure. So to clear things out, because Sajesh sort of, you know, blurred the line between the two stages, because the first stage is the ordinary world and the second stage is call to adventure. So, as Sarvesh rightly pointed out, so the ordinary world is the setting of any book or any movie or any story. And here you meet the character or the protagonist or the hero in a sense where, you know, you see them going on, them doing their everyday stuff. You meet them in their lifestyle. So when we first meet Iron Man, he is doing his normal, he's hooking up with girls, he's going to parties, and we have that whole montage in the beginning. If you see Harry Potter, we meet him in his cupboard under the stairs. He goes to the zoo, and we see how the Dursleys misbehave with him. When we look at Game of Thrones, we see that, you know, the North has just opened up. Ned Stark is beheading the person, the man who fled from the Night's Watch. So we are instantly introduced to the world of these characters, and then, you know, we see that there is a second stage that comes right after the ordinary world, which is the call to adventure. Now, the call to adventure is very important as a stage, because this is the stage where the hero or the characters of the story would essentially, you know, realize that they have to move into something which is beyond them. Like at this point of time, that they're chilling in their own lives, but now they cannot. And it is that point where, you know, things start changing. So, Sarvesh, can you take up on that? Like, when do call for adventure start for all of these three?
Essentially. So if you think about it, it has like three, from the three examples that we're taking up. In the Game of Thrones perspective, the call for adventure starts when Robert Baratheon comes to Winterfell and he asks for Ned Stark to be his hand, essentially. Yeah. And Ned agrees and he goes to Winterfell. So that is the call for adventure. When it comes to Harry Potter, it's Hagrid coming down and finding Harry and taking him shopping, essentially shopping, and then shipping him off to Hogwarts. So that is a call for adventure. And the third example at the end of the day would perhaps in Tony's case be the Avengers. It's Agent Coulson.
In Tony's case, it would be that the call to adventure comes when, you know, when he goes to Afghanistan and, you know, he gets captured there, because that is the moment when, you know, he's not ready for it. He's still in his normal world. He's in his car and he's going to Afghanistan. And then there is this huge, bombardment, and then he's captured.
That is also a call for adventure, definitely. Because that's when the adventure begins in a way.
Right? And I think what is very interesting is how in each of these stories, they all refuse the call to adventure, and which is also the third stage. So it is called refusal of the call, because what happens is that every time that there is this disruption which happens in the normal world for our heroes and our characters, now they don't really always want to, you know, end up being the heroes, right? As we already discussed. Because they are right now in the process of becoming heroes. So they are a little apprehensive as to say that they do not want to, you know, go into that world and, you know, do stuff like that. So they are sort of in double minds whether to go and become a part of the journey which they are ultimately destined to go. So that is what the refusal of the call is. And I think it's very evidently there in Game of Thrones, Harry Potter, as well as Iron Man. So, like, Sajid, if you remember in Game of Thrones, before Ned agrees to go to King's Landing, he and Catelyn Stark have a long, drawn discussion where Catelyn asks him not to go. And, you know, Ned Stark is constantly rethinking his decision as whether he should go or he should not go. Even for that, Harry Potter, you might want to talk about how when Hagrid comes in, Harry is still unsure because he does not.
Yeah, Harry is pretty much surprised and shocked as to like, you know, are you really looking for me? You might have the wrong person, and yeah. I'm not really that special. And yeah. Like, why me out of nowhere? Why me? So yeah, there's always that.
And even in Iron Man, for that matter, like when Yinsen discovers, and you know, he wants Tony Stark to build the, you know, the arc reactor.
Suit of armor, yeah.
Because he does not think that he will make it alive.
Yeah, so exactly.
Is, you know, that forms the crux of the refusal to the call, where our heroes and our characters are sort of not ready, you know, to go into the journey because they are too apprehensive of the fact. And, you know, that is the moment when the meeting with the mentor comes in. And with the mentor is, as the name suggests, it is the person who is the guru, or, you know, who comes out as a person who will guide this person, or who will put this person on the journey. For Harry, it was Hagrid who tells him, "You're a wizard, Harry." And for Game of Thrones, it was the, you know, the guru was, it was, there was not one guru because, you know, it's like a huge set of people. And there are too many characters.
And essentially the protagonists and the heroes keep changing in Game of Thrones.
Yeah,
so like it's Ned Stark, it's Robb Stark, it's Jon, it's Daenerys. They keep changing, yeah.
I think the ideas keep shifting, so we can't really identify one person. But for example, for Jon Snow, when we meet him, the guru is basically Benjen Stark, because, you know, he's the person who Jon admires, and, you know, he wants, that is why he takes up the black. For Robb, it is father, because he wants to be like his father. For Sansa, it is the whole idea of becoming the, you know, the like Cersei, because, you know, she wants to be the lady, and Cersei is, you know, the best example that she as an innocent can think for, because, you know, she is the queen, and Cersei does carry herself very well. So in that sense, a guru or the meeting with mentor can be different in Game of Thrones, but it is same. And for Iron Man, I think it's Yinsen. So would you like to talk about that?
Yeah, it's definitely Yinsen when it comes to Iron Man, because he's the one who pushed him to go beyond his comfort zone and actually do something that was out of the world. That was quite literally out of the world in some senses.
That sort of, you know, so that is when these people, you know, listen to their mentors. And we lead into the next stage, which is crossing the first threshold. Now, the first threshold is a very interesting aspect, because this is usually the problem that began with the character being thrown into the new world. And now the character has to go back, okay, and has to, you know, set everything back after he has decided that he wants to take up this journey. And you can, you know, give us the example so that audience can be, you know...
Yeah, so like the first stage perhaps would for Iron Man be when he finally escapes, gets back, has a cheeseburger, thinks about it, and makes his first suit of armor, and, you know, experiments with it, goes to a height in which he completely freezes.
Yeah.
And then at the same time, someone, like in the case of Game of Thrones, you could say that the first act is Ned standing up against, you know, Cersei. Or Ned having a stand, or Ned being a part of the ruling portion of King's Landing. And in the case of Robb, his first act could perhaps be getting the entirety of Winterfell together, the North together, to march up against Winterfell.
And I think she has something very important to say. She says, "Peter Quill has one of the best hero arcs. Fight me." Okay, Shruti, fight you in the end. Please stay tuned. We are definitely going to take up Peter Quill.
sure. Definitely.
Star-Lord, right? I mean, for a moment, I thought, I don't know why, but Professor Quirrell came into my mind.
Yeah, exactly. I was confused between Professor Quirrell and Peter Quirrell for a second.
I thought, what is wrong with Shruti? Why
Professor Quirrell being heroic act.
Because you know, Shruti, you should talk. You should say Star Lord, not Peter Quill. I sometimes forget. But anyway, so I mean that is what, you know, essentially has happened. We don't remember these characters' real names. We have been so acquainted with the superhero names, or the hero names that they have been given, or that they have made up for themselves, that we remember them by these names versus their real names, right? So that is,
yeah,
you know,
names, details, there are so much to it. Like, I mean, I as you know, as a lot of you might know, I've read Harry Potter a lot of times, like a lot of times, an unhealthy amount of times. But I still can't confidently say that I know every single detail. Like, I still need to think that, you know, murderers mein aapko kholne ke liye kaun sa spell tha. I'm up to no good. What? I'm up to no good. I solemnly swear I'm up to no good. So even like those small details, there's so much to it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that by the next, I'm going to just do a quick publicity for myself, which is why the next session that we're doing on next Saturday with Ankita Mishra is the Remembering Forgotten Characters, where we are discussing all the characters who came in and had some or the other role to play, but people forget them eventually because, you know, they are not that important to the plot. And anyway, coming back to the hero's journey, so that is, so after, you know, the hero has gone through the ordinary world, he has had the call to adventure, he then refuses the call, then he meets the mentor, and the mentor fills him with all the inspiration and the good so that he can cross the first threshold, which is the conflict at hand. And that is when, you know, the sort of the first act of the film ends. So for, in case of Iron Man, for example, Tony Stark going to Afghanistan, he then gets captured. He then meets Yinsen, who's the guru or the mentor. He fills him with all the information and the motivation. He then builds the arc reactor and then, you know, he wears it and then finally flees it. So that sort of brings an end to the first act of the film.
To the first act itself, yes.
That is where the second act begins, which is the test, allies and the enemies. Because as soon as a character returns back into his real world, he has to decide that, you know, what kind of a journey or what kind of life does he want to live. So, Savish, could you talk only from Tony Stark's perspective? Because again, we are a little, you know, short on time because it has a 1 hour limitation.
I feel that there's a better example to it, which is Harry Potter. If you think about it, the choice, the entire concept of choice came from Sorting Hat's perspective, came from waiting in front of the Great Hall, shaking Malfoy's hand or not, the offer that he's given to move someone away from hand-me-down robes as Ronald Weasley to being a part of Slytherin. And then ultimately, when the Sorting Hat comes on and it says that you would be amazing in Slytherin, to him consciously making that choice that he wants to be a Gryffindor or he wants to perhaps fight evil. As Slytherin was personified as evil at that point of time.
I think that is what defines the statement, you know, because not only he's making friends, but he's also, you know, understanding who the enemy is. Like, not exactly enemy, but who is on the other side of the table.
Who's on the other side,
Like, on the very first day itself, he realizes that, you know, Severus Snape is somebody who he would not gel well with. Malfoy will come with him as long as, you know, he chooses to stay with Ron and Hermione. And again, you know, he's constantly being put on tests. Like, even when he goes and sits on the stool and the Sorting Hat ceremony begins, so he's scared because he does not want to be a part of the Slytherin house because of the legacy that it carries. So that is the defining moment or the defining feature of that stage in the hero's journey. And which, you know, ultimately leads to the next stage, which is the approach to the innermost cave. And that is the place where the hero has now, you know, understood who my character, who my friends are, who my enemy is. And that is when the next big problem begins. So in terms of Harry Potter, could you give me an example as to how that happens? Like, after the sorting ceremony is done.
Yeah, so after the sorting ceremony is done. So even trivial moments in Harry Potter, a moment like when they have their first flying lesson and Malfoy takes Neville's Remembrall, which was a small glass ball which would make you remember something in case you've forgotten it.
Yeah.
Malfoy takes his Remembrall, and when Neville's taken off to the hospital wing because he fell down and broke his arm, and Malfoy is like, I'll leave it for somewhere for Longbottom to find, like on the top of a tree or something.
Yeah.
Harry is the one who has no flying lessons whatsoever. He's never been on a broomstick before this, but he still goes forward and he still challenges Malfoy.
I think it's called the approach to the innermost cave, right? Like, you are approaching your innermost demon. So, like, because
essentially,
know, Harry was, you know, sort of questioning his own sense. Because back then, as you said, Harry does not know how to fly. He has never been on a broom before. But he still out and he has that belief in himself that he can beat Masboy and get the Rememberal back. And he does it with, you know, with great ease. So that is what innermost cave is. Like, you know, you defeating your own inner demons. And
essentially, you're taking control of fear.
Yeah, which ultimately, you know, like leads to the crucial ordeal, which is the next stage in the hero's journey in the monomyth structure. So here what happens is that, you know, the character of the hero has to, you know, it comes face to face with a very big threat, which might be a life or death kind of a situation. And often is like a greatest, you know, it comes off as a greatest fear. And it is often many times, you know, people think that that is the climax of the story. But it is just the beginning, right?
Yeah.
So in Harry Potter, I think, Sarvesh, you can talk how it happens when they discover the trap door. You know, in the first book.
The trap door and the entire ending of the first book, if you think about it. The entire journey of going through the trap door and through all of those traps and then finally coming face to face with one form of Voldemort.
When you talk about ordeal, it is only about, you know, like them coming face to face with Fluffy, because, you know, they discover, like, they don't know what is inside the, what is he guarding. They just know
essentially,
that
something
is guarded. Right.
Yeah. So like it's like the adventure beginning, the entire main part of the adventure beginning, perhaps. It's the beginning of the end in a way.
The beginning of the end way. Yeah. And that is when, Sarvesh, I think, you know, these characters go on to a reward, because when you see that Fluffy is a magical beast, so these characters, Harry, Ron and Hermione, they go to a person who knows magical creatures, and it is Hagrid, and where they discover what is the way to, you know, move from to sort of control Fluffy, the dog, the three-headed dog. So that is reward, which is the next step after ordeal. And in this stage, as you might know, after they've come in face to face with the enemy or in some sort of a obstacle, they sort of realize that now they need something which would help them move forward. Which they get from Hagrid.
Yes.
Yeah, just freshen all of us about the whole thing that plays out. They are on the Quidditch grounds, and that is when they go to Hagrid, and the whole thing about the flute comes in.
Yeah, so Hagrid, essentially, last I remember, they go to Hagrid the next day, and they tell him about Snape, you know, cursing Harry's broom. And how Snape is against, Snape might be against Harry, and they tell him about Fluffy, and Hagrid. Actually, they tell him about the three-headed dog, and Hagrid is like, "You're not supposed to know about Fluffy." Harry's reaction to that is that he has a name. So it's essentially the entire concept of finding out how to deal with the ordeal, what's the next step forward, or what's the direction that they're going to go with.
So that is the reward that they get out of it, right? Like the
ordeal. Yeah, essentially.
They saw who is the enemy, or like, you know, the end, like a part of the enemy, like the dog.
Yeah.
And now they have to go beyond that. So to defeat the dog, which is now the temporary enemy, they get the reward from Hagrid, who tells them that, you know, by mistake, that it is the flute which will help them sleep. So that is what the reward
is. Some music.
The music. And music from my neighborhood has also started, because it's 7, so it is the normal temple. We have a temple near my house, so they start arti every time. So for us, the music has started. And, you know, Sarvesh, that sort of puts our characters or our heroes on the journey, which now deals with facing the enemy head on. Because if you remember, even in Harry Potter, after they know, like, Fluffy can, you know, can sleep with the flute, they don't
think with music,
is beyond. They just dive into it, right?
Yeah, essentially.
So that is our, you know, the 10th step, the road back, where they want to go on the journey, right? So, like, do you remember how they went on the journey? Like, they just one day, they just woke up and Neville is guarding the doors.
So there were some indications about perhaps, you know, someone trying to steal the Philosopher's or the Sorcerer's Stone. But it was mostly their presumption as to, like, it's going to happen tonight. We need to go right now.
Yeah.
Just dive into it, right? Straight up dive into it.
Yes.
So that entire like the biggest cue to that being perhaps that Dumbledore was not in Hogwarts at that point of time.
You know, they, like once they make it through Fluffy very quite easily, then they keep, you know, they find themselves in multiple challenges set by the different professors. You know, so that is sort of the road, you know, on which they are traveling.
And yeah, essentially.
That, you know, ultimately, you know, brings us to this point where, you know, it's called resurrection, where the character or the hero has to go through the final steps of, you know, of facing the enemy himself. And this state, a lot of times what happens, the allies, they fall, you know, they fall short. And the people, they are in a state of complete despair because as an audience, we think, you know, we have lost it. Like before the long night, we thought everybody's going to die. In Harry Potter, before he discovers it is Professor Quirrell, he has already gone crazy, right, about with the transfiguration chest because Ron is defeated. And he's lying on the ground and Hermione wants to stay back with Ron. And she tells him that, you know, you have to go all alone. So that is right?
Yeah, that is resurrection. I mean, there's a lot to it. So if you think about Devil's Snare, the plan that they fall down to from the trapdoor, to Hermione saving them, essentially. The entire concept of Harry Potter, which I essentially love in this perspective, because it shows how the trio was equally important in a lot of senses. Mm-hmm. And then it goes on to from Hermione saving them from the Devil's Snare to Harry getting the key in the chamber to Ron helping with the wizard's chest and then to Hermione saving with the potions again and then Harry going on to face Professor Quirrell. So that entire journey, the beauty of that entire journey is there.
That is what resurrection is also, you know, at the end of the day, because now Harry faced the demon that is Lord Voldemort in the form of Quirrell, because technically he was a parasite, and he comes face to face with him and he fights him, and he sort of resurrects because he also has Philosopher's Stone. And before we go ahead with the final journey, I think Shruti mentions that there are some things in life you can't go through without becoming friends. Fighting a troll,
is one of them.
Very true, Shruti.
Which is on point. Which is on point.
I would like to rephrase this quote and say that there are some things in life you can't go through without becoming friends, and reading Harry Potter is one of them, right? Because
that is actually very true.
Yeah, because if we were not all Potterheads and if we did not love Harry Potter as much as we love it, even though J.K. Rowling is going crazy at this point of time with all the trans, but you know, it is still connecting us all together in a way that nothing else can, right?
Yeah. It has been connecting us in a way that nothing else can for over a decade, I believe, no?
Yeah.
So,
Yeah, and I think, Savesh, that, you know, sort of brings me to the final state also, which is return with the elixir, which is basically that now the hero has fought the enemy and the enemy has been defeated and the hero now needs to return back to his normal world. Right. So that happens the moment when, you know, Lord Voldemort is defeated or Professor Quirrell is defeated in Philosopher's Stone, and Harry Potter ends up in the hospital bed and, you know, Dumbledore comes and meets him and greets him. So now is the time when Dumbledore finally reveals to Harry that how, you know, Lily Potter had casted a spell, and which is why, you know, Voldemort cannot touch him, and so on and so forth. And so, you know, so this is the time when Harry realizes that he is no longer an ordinary man. He has changed so much that he cannot be the same innocent 11-year-old which he wants to be. Because now
He's still 11-year-old. He's still 11.
Chosen one, right?
Yeah, so, but like, return with the elixir, the entire state, in fact, like, because of him being 11-year-old, something like the house points that were awarded at the end of the book and the movie. Those house points that won Gryffindor the house cup, that itself is a small part of that elixir. That itself is a small part of the spoilt of the war, essentially. Yeah, definitely. So,
to sum it up, everyone, I think both me and Sarvesh discussed the monomyth structure by Joseph Campbell. And we took you through the entire stage where how the journey of a hero is formed and how in the beginning of this journey, the hero is someone or is just a normal everyday person who does not want to be a hero, who is just like us, like you and me, like Sarvesh. And you know, then something happens in our world and we are completely disrupted. We are thrown into a situation where we cannot refuse the call because that is the only way to move forward. We then come and meet the guru, and then we go on a journey. We become, we know our friends, we know our enemies. We constantly face multiple conflicts and we overcome them until the time when we get a reward that finally leads us to the final climax of the problem, the biggest, the dramatic problem of the story. And then we defeat him and the hero then comes back and he then becomes a hero. So that
is essentially
the basic structure of the monomyth. And I think Sarvesh made it very clear with today's example with Harry Potter, and we couldn't take up Game of Thrones so much because, you know, we are bound with the time here with Instagram. And Shruti now tells me so dramatic, Chaitanya cannot help Shruti. You know, I have a flair for drama in my life. That is
essentially, otherwise this wouldn't be happening.
Which is why you can also explain my absolutely dramatic choices in my dating life. But anyway, as somebody wanted us.
Okay, that's a different conversation altogether. We need a live stream about that.
Yeah. So I think now we can take up some questions if there are in the audience about heroes and heroine making. And Shruti or Purna or people who I see here, Snigdha, Radhika, Ayushi, maybe you guys or Rubaina, you guys can all, you know, maybe drop in whatever questions you might have or any comments or any observations that you would might want us to take
or up. We could also address Star-Lord's heroic arc.
Shruti said something also about Dumbledore, and she said that Dumbledore was not a good mentor, and she said fight me into two, which is the second thing. So which one do you want to discuss, because we can't discuss both today?
I think I'm gonna go with Dumbledore, because how dare you.
Okay.
As simple as that.
But I think in that aspect I would be on Shruti's side. And,
yeah, fight me. That's fine by me. The reason why I say that Dumbledore was at the end of the day a great mentor is because the entire concept is not to be handed everything. You're not a mentor is not supposed to set up the entire stage and be like, you go do this. If the hero can't do anything on his or her own accord, then that person is not a hero. Then the person is a parrot. And Dumbledore set up the stage. Dumbledore told Harry that, you know, this is the premise of it. Dumbledore was the premise of the seventh book. The reason why he's not a part of the seventh book is because that's where Harry comes into the limelight properly. That's where it's all about the journey that Harry has with Ron and Hermione. And Dumbledore is a mentor. He's not the doer. He's not the protagonist. He's not the end hero. Although he is a major part of the series, but he's still not it. He's not the finishing part.
Okay, so we have exactly 1.55 seconds remaining. 1 minute 55. So I will give you a counter to it, you know, Sarvesh, to what you said. Because in my eyes, when I look at Dumbledore and Harry's relationship, you know, I see that Harry is just a boy. As Shruti is pointing out that, you know, he's just 16. So Harry is someone who's not born and brought up in the magical world. So his ideas as to how the magic works or, you know, what are the rules and regulations and everything besides that is formed when he enters the world. And while Dumbledore, you know, sort of acts as this father figure, turned mentor, turned guru, turned the principal of his school and everything rolled into one. That sort of is the problem because, you know, he does not really draws a line. And you see that Harry, a lot of times, he has so much of expectations from Dumbledore because Dumbledore is very unpredictable. At times, Dumbledore, you know, gives away too much. And at times, Dumbledore holds back a lot. Because
at the end of the day, before we end this, I'd like to just answer to Shruti. He was 16, but at the end of the day, it was not Dumbledore's choice to die. It was a mistake on Dumbledore's end to die.
Yeah.
So it's not he leaves. It's not like he leaves Harry anywhere.
Yeah.
It's more of the fact that he has no other choice left.
Yeah.
So that is also there.
That is So I think that is a very nice
consequence.
That conversation that we had, and we will get back.
that's very true. Dumbledore is Willy Wonka without narcissism. That's very true.
Yeah, so we will get back to this conversation very soon, maybe in September with another round of the hero in making with another hero.
Definitely. Thank you, sir.